a sudden, one of these missiles hits, and all of a sudden, I stepped down, and I committed an act that was not honoring to the Lord. 1 John 1:9, if I confess my sin, then I back up here, walking with the Lord again. Well, we saw in James 1:14 that every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own secret desires and enticed. So the enemy's finding something that's working in my life. It worked once. So in all probability, what will he do? He'll try again. And all of a sudden, I've gone down one more step. I start to practice that act. It's working. The enemy is keeping me defeated. Well, he keeps sending these arrows in this area. And there may be more steps in this, but you just get the picture here. I begin to build habit patterns at this point. And this still may be just kind of an outward kind of a thing. At any point, I could ask forgiveness and go back up, but I don't. I keep resisting what? The grace of God, which will allow me to go back up. The next step down, when a person's down here, we know there's tremendous demonic aspects in their life. And this is when they're in bondage. When they get into the bondage area, this bondage has to be broken so they can get back up here. And sometimes the steps go back up. You have to, we're going to talk a little bit about this. But today we want to try to finish Ephesians chapter 6 and share some things with you on warfare, the actual warfare. We went through the things that brings a person to bondage. We talked about everything. We ended with the sexual thing last time. And then what we do in counseling is we have the final prayer. We do not deal with the demonic stuff at all until after we've dealt with all of the ground, the topaz. So all that's taken back. Then we deal with the demonic. Now, we deal with the demonic if we have to. If you see someone taken over and their eyes are going, or the person is, like I shared with the Campus Crusade area director, they hit the floor and crawled like a snake, I had to do something. You know, we just started praying God's protection. There he's on the floor crawling like a snake for, he's over, I think, 5 or 6 states. And he was really in trouble. So we had to deal with it. I mean, we actually had an outward manifestation. And we just couldn't say, well, it's not time yet. You know, we've got 4 more days before we deal with it. You deal with that right then. But we knew that we had to deal with ground before we could really help him. We just commanded this stuff to stop in his life and him to stay with me. It's amazing. Some of the people that have had the worst outward demonstration have been missionaries, pastors, and youth pastors, and campus leaders, things like that. You know, where you've seen more violent demonstrations just as we're sitting with them trying to get started. Turn to Ephesians chapter 6, and while you're turning, what we do then, the very last step, is to deal with familiar spirits, ancestral spirits, curses in a general way, or, you know, anything. We have a special prayer that we use at the very, very end. Then we command all spirits in or around the person to leave and to go where Jesus Christ commands them to go, never to come back again. I never tell a person they're free. I can't see inside. But God can tell them they're free. Then we ask the Spirit of God to fill that individual, and the Spirit of God, that his spirit would bear witness with their spirit, that we've dealt with everything that God wants us to deal with in their life, and that God would do this by giving them a sense of an inner sense that God loves them, a joy would spring up in their heart, and that they would have an inner witness of peace. Then we say, Lord, if there is anything that we've missed, we were deceived or we missed something and the enemy still got a grip on their life, we ask right now that you would put a check in their spirit. And little kids will say right there, Logan, there's something else. I had peace, and I got darkness now, or a heaviness came in my heart. Immediately, the Spirit of God wants us free, and we'll say, all right, Lord, reveal to their mind what is it. What is that area of their life that we haven't dealt with? And often it's a resentment that they really didn't really deal with, and God just brings it up, and we deal with it, and then the peace just overwhelms. Often you can see it in their face. I mean, you can see people being relieved as the time goes, but when peace comes, when God does a total work on someone's life, you just see it. It just radiates from their face. And I know by looking at them, because I usually pray watching. You know, there's something in the Bible about that. I've shut my eyes, they hit the floor, so I don't shut my eyes anymore. I watch when I see a moving, I just pray against it. Well, so that's basically what we do. And then what we need to do, I really believe that coming to freedom is the very easiest part.
I tell them, that's the easiest part. God wants me free. For you to come to freedom, I don't care what the sexual bondage is or the emotional bondage or voices or schizophrenia, if it's not really schizophrenia, if it's the demonic stuff that's called schizophrenia or whatever is going on, that's really easy to deal with. The hard thing for all of us is to maintain our freedom, isn't it? I mean, that's really where it's hard. It's to continue a walk in freedom. Now, let's look at Ephesians 6. Remember, Paul has dealt with a lot of neat things before chapter 6. And this book is arranged by the Holy Spirit for a real way. You have dealing in chapter 1. Do you know who you are in Christ? Chapter 1 and 2. You get into don't grieving the Holy Spirit and all the kinds of sins, because you can't walk in victory and be an angry man. You can't walk in victory and have bitterness. You can't walk in victory and have malice in your heart and all of that. It's just, it's not there yet. You got to deal with that. Then you have to be filled with the Spirit so you can have what? Proper relationships. That follows that. And after relationships are proper, then it gets into the warfare. Now you're in a place to do spiritual warfare. Because if you're not spiritual, it won't be spiritual warfare. It may be something, but it won't be spiritual warfare. So in verse 10, he says, finally, my brethren, and I can't help but wonder if this was not Paul's deep desire to teach this first. But he says, now, finally, I can get to what I want to get to here because I know the situation you're going into. When you go into these areas, what are you getting into? I mean, from what I'm hearing, that your area is parallel Ephesus, demons and sex. Right? You know, the immorality is just so common and the demonic stuff is so heavy. That was the two problems at Ephesus. So this is a book. I think it's amazing. It seems to be the one you translate last. Am I right? You know, we only have Ephesus last. You know what I mean? I've heard it said a few times now. I'm going, maybe you ought to move it up a little bit in your schedule. That Ephesians, you know, I only have Romans and Ephesians left. And I think I've heard that two or three times. So I would put Ephesians up a little bit, especially in an area where you know, this book really deals with their issues. But he says, finally, my brethren, in verse 10, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Now, he doesn't explain this because he explained it in chapter 1 and part of chapter 2. We looked at that when I first started speaking. It seemed like a long time ago. But we looked at exactly, because this is so important. If I understand who I am in Christ, now I can get into the battle. The second thing he tells us in verse 11 is to put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles or the schemes of the enemy. And then in verse 12, whatever translation you have that you're using, you'll find that he says in the first part of verse 12, for we, and then you go down to 13 and he says, wherefore take unto you. And you know, if you've worked on this, that this is unique for Paul because he changes pronouns. He says, you put on the armor in verse 11. He says, you put on the armor in verse 13. But he says in verse 12, we all. And it's unusual for Paul to identify himself with the hearers in this kind of a thing. And what's he telling us here? He was putting on the armor. But he said, I want you to understand that we all wrestle the forces of darkness. All of us. None of us miss. The question is not, are you wrestling the forces of darkness? The question is what? How are you doing? See, how are you doing? Are you winning or losing? Because we're all in this spiritual battle. He says in verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Remember that. Most of the struggles we have with people. And we get upset with people. And it's a people thing. And we have to realize that behind these people can be forces of darkness that are attacking me through these people. And I need to look behind the battle. Our battle is not people. Our battle is spiritual. And it's spiritual forces that are seeking to influence individuals to carry out Satan's plan for this earth. And so be careful in getting caught up in people fighting. You know what I'm saying? People fighting. Don't get involved in it. That's of the enemy. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. There seems to be four identifications of four demonic forces here. Some have said, we looked through your material and we didn't see anything on territorial spirits. Well, a lot of people have written books on territorial spirits. A lot of stuff is coming out in that area, but we do have a paper in there that I really suggest that you get. It's 5 pages long, and it's called Taking Our Cities for God. It's written by Ed Savoso. You said, so who's Ed Savoso? Luis Palau's brother-in-law. And they're using his material in Argentina. You know what's happening in Argentina. Thousands and thousands and thousands are coming to Christ by following that 5-page plan that I have in there. They're using it in Calgary, Alberta. And they want to see, will it work in a more of a Western situation? They're also using it in Indianapolis. And they're putting this plan in, and it's just awesome in how to take a city. And I know you're not establishing churches, but you may have a pastor that you're close to in your area that you say, look at this. This is working other places. Here's a way of being able to take, and you know, Argentina was one of the most difficult mission fields in the world at one time. You talk to the missionaries that went out there years ago that were being killed and persecuted by the Catholics and so on. And what's happening today is tremendous in that country. And they're following this thing. I didn't understand principalities and powers for a long, long, long time. But I knew that they were there. The first time I've ever experienced a territorial spirit, one that was assigned to a geographical location, is when I flew to Molokai. I didn't know what I was getting into. I got off the airplane at Molokai. And if you've been to Molokai, it's one of the Hawaiian islands, and you get off, and they have an airport with orchids and all this stuff. And I stepped in there, and I was still teaching at the Bible college, I think, at that time or something, and I did not understand the spirit world. And the missionary walked up to me, and this wasn't a very good statement to make. You know, the first time you meet these people, I'm supposed to speak at a lot of different missionaries and Christian schools on the island. I just said, how can you guys stand to live here? Now, I had been on Maui and had just finished a series on Maui, and this was a number of years ago, and I said, how can you guys stand to live here? And they said, it's interesting that you said that. The wife said, you know, I can only stand staying on this island by going into the hotel and getting a Coke once a week and flying out of this island once a month. And you know, Molokai only has one hotel, American hotel, because the tourists can't stand it there. It is the most oppressive, it is the most unbelievable feeling when you land there and everything is pretty. You know, it's the first time I ever experienced that whatever. Do you know which country of the world has more missionaries committing suicide than any other country? Austria. I can't tell you the missionaries that get wiped out in Austria with terrible depressions and hopelessness. And they know that they're over that country. The spirit that's over there, our missionaries that traveled, as I begin to share this with our missionaries and CEF, they're going, man, this makes sense. You can tell which communist country, and this is back when they were traveling behind the Iron Curtain, you could tell which communist country you're in by how you felt. The feeling in East Germany was not the same as in Romania, and Romania was not the same as Yugoslavia, and Yugoslavia was not the same as Czechoslovakia, and on in Poland. Every single country had a different feel for the whole country. And as soon as you crossed the border and went in that country, you came under this. One fellow I know who was a school teacher, a tremendous guy, his father was a board member of Grace College of the Bible, board member of CEF. His son was going to be a missionary with CEF. And so as he was raising his support and he quit his job and sold his home and all this kind of stuff to go to Romania as a missionary, he decided to go over there. They said, why don't you come over early and see the country and come back. It'll help in deputation. He went to Romania, spent 30 days, came back, walked into my office, said, Logan, I'm quitting the mission. I said, what do you mean you're quitting the mission? I mean, you're not even, you know, you haven't even got your support up yet, and you're quitting already. He said, I could never live over there. I said, why? He said, I was in sheer fear for 30 days, and I can't live like that. And you ask any missionary in Romania, you know what they'll tell you it's over that country? A spirit of fear. And as soon as you're there, you begin to have this horrible fears, irrational fears. And he said, I can't live. I mean, if I can't handle 30 days of this, how am I going to handle years of this? You know what? He didn't realize what was happening, and he didn't stand against it. So we see principalities. In the King James, I know it breaks down, but you can check it out in the Greek. It's not principalities. It's not the best definition, but the King James makes it real easy because prince is one appointed. A palady is a geographical location. And Satan has assigned these spirits Just as there is a ranking of spirits in the angels, there's a ranking of demonic spirits. And these spirits seem to be assigned to geographical locations, and their purpose is to hold that area in darkness and to do everything they can to influence and to stand against any kind of gospel penetration. And if I move into an area and I don't identify what's going on, and remember we said spirits are only spirits of influence, after a while I will come under that influence and I'll buy it. And I start living horribly depressed, or I start living horribly in fear, or whatever it happens to be, or what's over America. Most missionaries say, I know what's over America. Temporal values. Man, everybody's caught up in things. Well, I'll tell you, if you don't live against that and pray against that, you get caught up in that. I mean, every time we move, we need a bigger barn. Yeah, that's the truth. Two moving trucks. They can't get all our things in one. I can't believe all the things we've got. You know, and I never thought we'd have things. You know, it just didn't seem to be a thing to me to look at all the things. But it's our country. That's what's all over our country. Now, the second one that we have to deal with, principalities and powers. Powers I see as spirits that want to seek to influence individual behavior. If you take people who are bound by a particular type of demonic bondage, and you put them together in a geographical location, and you stack them up or crowd them in, when you go into that area, you will sense that power. You go in the welfare hotels in New York City that CEF is working in. Every single hotel, you get a different feeling. I remember we walked into one. I mean, these places are the pits. You want to see a pit? Go to a welfare hotel in New York City on Manhattan Island. They are the pits. You know, 1,000 kids or 1,500 kids in this welfare hotel living there. And you walk in. I mean, we walked into one and we had a Good News Club where 500 kids came to the club in a room like this. You ever had 500 hyperactive kids that are all sexually abused in a room like this? Let me tell you, it's like going to the snake pit. And I'm going, this is hopeless. You know, I'm the vice president, the encourager of the mission, and I'm going, man, this place is hopeless. I mean, I walked right through the door, walked right in that building, and I'm getting all those hopeless feelings. And I'm sitting there going, man, I'm sure glad I'm not working here. You know, this is hopeless. What are you going to do? You know, the kids there. We have girls upstairs, one floor of prostitutes, all under the age of 11. You know, all upstairs in this hotel that they're working these kids. And, you know, you see young boys with new tennis shoes on. You know he's selling himself to older men. Pedophiles pick up these kids. And I can show you where you can get all the kids you want in New York City. You won't know it because you know what you're seeing. But you can get kids that are for sale there, little kids. It just makes you sick. Well, this is hopeless. So we walked out, and here I'm teaching all this stuff, and one of the missionaries says, what'd you feel in there? I said, hopelessness? He said, we all do. So wait till the next one. He said, I'll ask you what you feel on that one. And we had some guys that had never been into this. They shared what they felt when they went in this building. Went into another one right across from Macy's. If you've ever been in New York City, a welfare hotel on the outside looks really neat, but the inside's a pit. Went in that place, and I got really afraid. And they're both pitful, but I didn't feel the same in this one. And they said, how'd you feel in that one? And I said, I felt really afraid. Yeah, they said, you know, there's a spirit of violence in here. Everybody listening here feels afraid. Now, this one over here, they feel hopeless. They don't feel afraid. But in this one, everybody's afraid. I mean, you have hundreds of people in this. I mean, thousands of people in here. And they're all afraid. You go into, it was amazing. We had a doctor with us. As you understand, I like to take people with me when I travel so that they might see and maybe get involved in ministries. I took a doctor and a businessman with me in New York City. We took if you know anything about New York, we took the Staten Island Ferry, passed the Statue of Liberty, ended on the dock, went down into the subway, came up on 42nd Street. As we came, this is broad daylight, we come out on 42nd Street, and I was behind the guys. We're walking up to this welfare hotel that they might see what CEF is doing to try to reach these kids that have absolutely no hope apart from Christ. I mean, no hope apart from Christ. And as we're walking up the street, the doctor turned to the businessman, and he said, in the broad daylight, New York City, he said, I'm afraid. And he said, you know, so am I. He said, the last time I felt like this is when my hand, and he has fingers blown off, when I was on patrol in Vietnam. And you know, we went around the corner, and as soon as we walked off 42nd Street and turned the corner, it stopped. Because the people there we're bound with a certain type of spirit. It's not a principality, it's the power. You go to San Francisco, you may feel what? You know what? When you have so many people living in a city that are bound in a certain kind of sin. The Hispanic community in Los Angeles, I have a nephew who's in the helicopter, the LA Police Helicopter Division. I only have two nephews. The other one's an LA sheriff. No sheriff and no LA policeman wants to patrol the Hispanic community in Los Angeles because there's such a spirit of violence there. And we could blindfold you and drive you in the car, and as soon as you drive in there, you're going to feel it. You're just going to feel very uneasy and unsafe. You may find that. We found that we used to drive through St. Louis. Didn't know anything about St. Louis. Drive through it at night, and always you think, oh, I hope I don't break down here. Did you ever have that feeling? And all it is walls going up. Well, and after we moved there, I'm glad we didn't break down there. I didn't know what was there, but I had this feeling. These people, it was a very bad area. You may cross a bridge, and on one side of the bridge you feel fine. The other side of the bridge you don't feel real fine. And you find it's because of the bondage of the people there. And if you have enough people, you can sense it. And you need to pray against it. Or if you don't, you can be caught up with that influence. And all of a sudden, you're being influenced by this whole thing. It has changed the missionaries in CEO. When they realized what was seeking to influence them and what? Resisting it. Or to resist it. And it won't have an effect on me. But if I don't, I become a victim rather than a victor. We have two more. So we have principalities that seem to be assigned to geographical locations, and you can read books where they prayed and they passed out tracts on one side of the street because it was Uruguay, and they prayed and the people took them in Uruguay. They went on the other side of the street, which was Brazil, and they didn't pray and the people threw them down on the ground. And when people crossed the street from one side to the other side of the street, as soon as they crossed over where they had prayed and asked God to stop the influence while they were witnessing, the people would cross the street, would take the tracts and read them. And there's all kinds of stories like this you can get that are in Missionary Quarterly Review. You know, if you get that, if you know what I'm talking about, you can read this stuff all over. And it's documented by missionary, by missionary, by missionary. There are spirits out there that are assigned. I mean, Satan is very orderly, and he's working his work. Now, there's two more. One is the rulers of the darkness of this world. And I know that translations put it differently, but I believe these are the spirits that are behind leadership. And that's why I was so thrilled when I spoke to congressmen and senators and stuff on spiritual warfare and told them they had spirits assigned to them to affect their decision-making process so that the work of Satan could go on effectively in America. And it's unbelievable. Some of the Supreme Court decisions by the men on the Supreme Court women that you would never have thought would have voted the way they voted. They voted totally out of their conservativeness. That was not good. It's amazing. The enemy is seeking to take over. The last is spiritual wickedness in high places. And we see those as religious spirits that are promoting falsehood in the last days. Who visits? Where's the couple lives at the end of the road? Was it the Lubecks? You guys live at the end of the road and all these weird people come and see you? The Willems. Okay. Okay. It's amazing. The weird people that come to see them, what are they into? And why are they out on the end of a dirt road in a foreign country? They're going out to get power from the ruins. The New Age is all over the world. They have no headquarters or no missionaries. And I've never been anywhere where I haven't, except flying down here, that I don't have a New Ager sitting by me in an airplane. And they're going all over to these places where there's been life sacrifices and everything to ask these powers to come in them. How do you explain the New Age in all the universities in Europe? I mean, it's just everywhere. It's a work of the enemy. You know, he's propagating this religious lie, and people are buying it. I spoke at a Bible college, and the president got real upset and said I could never come back again. But I spoke on what they told me to speak on. And so I mentioned in that school about the unbelievable moving of the New Age. And they said I was a little bit, you know, a little too off here, and it wasn't so. Now, this school is a school that is in nowhere America. I mean, unless you've ever been on that road, you've never went by that school, many of you have never even heard of that school, it is nowhere in the mountains. And so after I spoke, I didn't realize that the president was real upset. One of the students said, you want to go over to the mall. They happen to have a mall there, and people came from all over to this mall. And he said, for a Coke. And I said, who's buying? He said, I am. I said, well, I'll go. And so we went to the mall, and he says, Logan, do you really think that the New Age is, you know, as powerful as what you're saying? I mean, after all, we're in nowhere America. And I said, yeah, I really think so. He said, well, I work in this mall. He said, I'm off today, but let's go over to the Walgreen or whatever, you know, the bookstore in the mall. So we went over there to that mall, and he walked in, and he said, you know, this man's been talking to us. He says, do you have any New Age books here? And she said, yes. He said, where are they? He said, New Age section. He didn't know that. So we went over to New Age section, you know, and looked at all this stuff. And he asked the lady, and this was in February, the 1st of February. And he said, do you sell any of this stuff? She said, from October to January, we sold more out of this than the rest of the whole store. And he said, Logan, I can't believe this. We're nowhere. And he said, let's go down to the music. You can talk New Age music. I said, yeah, there's New Age stations in Chicago and Los Angeles. All they play is New Age music all day long. And he said, well, we went there. We went to a New Age music store. Or went to the store and said, do you have New Age music? She said, yes. He said, where do you have it? She said, you know, like dummy, in the New Age music section. So he went over there in this mall of nowhere, and here's all this New Age music. And he asked her, do you sell this stuff? She said, we sell more of this music than any other music in the store. And this is nowhere. She says, I'll play a record of New Age music like on Saturday, and when I'm playing it, I'll sell all of that record. Because if you haven't heard New Age music, it's not rock music. It's music that doesn't end. It just goes on and on, and it stops. It has no, what do you call it, music stops? Solution, that's it. There's no solution. Some of it's very beautiful or very beautiful sounding. Resolution or whatever, okay. Now, let's go on to verse 13. So these are what we're wrestling against. We're wrestling against spirits that seem to be assigned to hold areas. Remember, Daniel came in contact with a principality. Do you remember that? Daniel prayed. His prayer wasn't answered, and it wasn't answered, and it wasn't answered, and Daniel wondered if prayer worked. Probably. He didn't say that, but I think he probably did. And 21 days later, this angel comes and said, I came immediately when you prayed. I was met by the prince of Persia, who is this demon assigned to Persia, to hinder your praying, and for 21 days we battled in heaven. And I brought your answer, and you go to the end of that chapter, and he said, but I've got to get back up there because the prince who's been assigned to Greece is going to join him, and I need to get involved in that battle. So I'm not talking about something that isn't in the Word. Spirits were in the Word assigned to countries. And we need to pray against it. Pray against what's in your area. What's happening to you? And you can often identify by how you feel. Okay, verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, having all done all to stand, stand therefore. So obviously we're to do some standing here. The word that I never could understand, and I always, you know, as a good Christian, jumped it, is the evil day. I thought, well, is that like the day of God or the day of Christ or, you know, what is the evil day? And I had no idea what it was, but Kenneth Weiss, I think, said it the best. Dr. Weiss said, it refers to a particular day. It's the day of violent temptations whenever they come to you. You ever had an evil day? There is a, if I can think of the book, around our office, we use this. It's one of the Minor Prophets. I can't even think of the Minor Prophets. No, it wasn't him. He was an evangelist. I think that's it. Habakkuk, is it 1:9 or 2:9 in there? But we always use that I can't even think of the reference. Habakkuk 2:9, you read about the guy? We're saying we're having Habakkuk 2:9 day, it's the evil day, where the guy is walking down the street and he meets a lion. And the lion roars, so he runs, and he runs into a bear. And so he runs from the bear. He runs in his house. He shuts the door, and he goes, whew, puts his hand on the wall and gets bit by a snake. That's a Habakkuk 2:9 day or whatever. You know, if you ever had one of those, that's one of these days. It's like, what else can happen? That's your evil day. It's like, I can't handle one more thing. It's just, it comes and it comes and it comes and it comes. And I'm just ready to give up or be defeated or whatever. And that's that day. And he says, you better be sure that you understand the armor so you can stand when that day comes. It's not every day. Thank the Lord. Because you and I could not handle a day like this every day. But they do come. And when they come, they are what? Overwhelming. Remember I told you my evil day? You're going to owe $14,000 in your wife's insurance. You walk in the house and water's running down the wall, but our house is a gorgeous, beautiful house that's been restored. It's an old, old, old house that's been restored, and I get to see all the plaster on the floor, you know, and I got this big hole, you know, all of a sudden opened up underneath my deck, and I think my house is going to fall in it, you know, and I'm laying in bed, and I'll tell you, I wasn't very victorious. Now, I had the victory, but I wasn't standing in it. I was being wiped out. And, you know, often I don't think about the evil day when I'm in the evil day because I'm thinking about the evil of the day. You know what I'm saying? I don't realize, wait a minute, Logan, this is what Paul's talking about here. It's happening to you. You better stand. Now, how do we stand? And we want to make the armor simple as much as possible. I've read, I have, as I told you, a lot of books. I have one book on the armor by Banner and Truth. It's two volumes, 3,000 pages. Well, if I have to remember 3,000 pages, a book written in 1657 on the armor, I'm in trouble. You know, and you could be overwhelmed by it. It gets so complicated. And I think it's wonderful to see all the applications and all that, but I got to have it what? Simple or I won't remember to use it. And I'm going to try and keep it as simple as possible. The first thing he tells us as we're standing. Now, some people ask, do you pray the armor on every day? I do not. Mark Bubeck and his wife pray the armor on every day. And they use Victor Matthew's prayer, which we have in the stuff. Warren Wiersbe and his wife pray the armor on every day. Warren Wiersbe gives, we have a sample of his prayer. Charles Stanley, some of you have heard of Charles Stanley. Charles Stanley says he puts the armor on over his pajamas every day. You know, and then he gets out of bed. Now he's ready to meet the day. So some people do it every day. Some people don't do it every day. You know, but don't do the beads, right? Hail Mary, full of grace. You know, it just absolutely, I mean, that happens. Then it's nothing. You know what I'm saying? It becomes nothing. And it's this is symbolic. It means something. You know, he just used the Roman soldier. In fact, a guy drew for me, an artist, drew a picture of this English soldier. And I said, I can't use it. It's not a Roman soldier. So he went to the library. There are three volumes in color of what the Roman soldiers used in the Roman army, which is updated about every 2 years. We tried to figure out as accurately as possible when Ephesians was written and drew that one, because that's who Paul was talking about, how he looked. And they didn't have the English arm, right? It was flat on the bottom. They stood up and so on. The shields, they didn't, you know, they didn't look like a lot of what you're visualizing. It's wrong, terribly wrong. So he says, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. Now, you know, I've got a belt on this morning, but it wasn't the first thing I put on. And yet in the armor, you know, it seems kind of strange that the very first thing he talks about, what, is the belt. Why? Because it holds everything together and everything hooks on it. And if I don't have the belt on, nothing fits. And what is it? Truth. Truth can only be two things. What I perceive to be true are God's truth, right? That's the only two truths there are. And we know what it is. What is it? God's truth. Remember it says that a threefold cord is hard to be broken? Well, I believe that possibly that the belt of truth has four cords. The cord number one is the Lord Jesus Christ, the person of truth. Cord number two would be the Bible, which God calls the word of what? Truth. The third cord is the Holy Spirit, which is what? The spirit of truth. And the fourth is the church, which is called the pillar of truth. Those are the four things that God calls the truth. And they make the belt. Now, why does God want me to put on truth? Who am I going to meet today? The father of lies. And if I don't have truth, I'm not going to stand, because what's he going to do? Lie to me. And so I need to be in truth. You know what I think the first attack on a missionary is? Or on any Christian worker, or any Christian, is to get you to stop reading your Bible. That's the first attack. I don't mean translating the Bible. I'm talking about you reading the Bible for yourself. Because if you don't know truth, he's got you. Or he will got you. You know what I mean? It's going to come. And so we get busy. You guys ever get busy? You know, it's so hard to get into the Word, isn't it? I mean, there's so much to do that it's hard to get in the Word. You know, I've got children, I got this, I got that. Well, you know, drown the kids. I don't know. But get in the Word because you're a sitting duck. You're a sitting duck if you don't know truth. Okay, you heard it here first. I can hear you writing your prayer letters. We had this guy that came and spoke on warfare. Step number one, drown the kids. Okay. The second piece of the armor is the breastplate of righteousness. That can only be two kinds of righteousness, either my righteousness or Christ's righteousness. And when I'm meeting the enemy, what righteousness am I to stand in? Christ's righteousness. It is so beautiful to realize he took my sin and he gave me his what? Righteousness. And we're standing in his righteousness. Who are we going to meet today? The accuser of the brethren. And you know what Jesus said in the Gospel of John? Satan is coming today, but he can find nothing in me to touch. Is that true of you in your righteousness? No, but it's true of me in Christ's righteousness. I walked in one time. In fact, that Bible school I was at, the head RA asked me if he could bring his brother for me to talk to. I'll make it real quick on this illustration, but I walked into the room. This guy didn't know who I was. We had a bunch of missionaries in our building, and it had 74 like rooms. I knocked on the door. I walked in. The kid's looking out the window. He turns around and looks at me, and he says, "Logan?" And he didn't know who I was. And the brother was behind the door. I didn't know the brother was in the room. I just wanted to be sure they were there. It was on a Sunday afternoon. He said, "Logan, we're not afraid of you." That's interesting. One guy talking, "We're not afraid of you." So I went over and sat on the bed and looked at him. I said, "Why would you be afraid of me?" And he says, "We're not afraid of you, and we want you to know it." And I said, "I'm not here representing Jim Logan. I'm here representing the Lord Jesus Christ." And the voice said, "We're afraid of him." So we better realize who we are in and whose righteousness we have when we go into battle. Because my righteousness is big enough to drive a tank through. Swiss cheese. You know, it's his righteousness. Not mine. And I have to realize, and we keep trying to establish our own righteousness. You know, for years, it was hard for me to believe. I mean, you guys look really decent people, but I know what you're like. You're rotten. Your heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. And I kept trying to find something good rather than agreeing with God. That my heart, that really within me, dwelleth no good thing. But I was looking for something good. And I got really depressed. I went to a lady, some of you know, Inez McGahee, who taught at Biola, and I was super depressed. And I went to this lady, and I said, "I can't get out of my depression." She said, "It was when we had the chapel speaker that told everybody to be searching their hearts and all that stuff, introspection." And I said, "Yes." And she said, "What did you expect to find when you were searching the garbage of your life?" "Well, at least a half good apple." She said, "You're looking in the wrong place." See, I got my eyes on myself rather than on who? My righteousness. I was trying to establish my own. And the more I looked, the more discouraged I got. So don't bother to look in here. You know, my hope is in Christ, not in me. That's why I became a Christian. And then the fifteenth, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. He's not talking about us going out preaching the gospel. I hear people use that. That may be an application. He's talking about here, I'm fighting an enemy. There were two things that caused the Roman soldiers to win, if you study anything about the Romans. One was their shoes. Their shoes were designed with cleats in a special way that had them grip the ground. And if you're doing a sword fight with somebody and you lose your footing, you're in trouble. And so they had a real advantage over all the armies they were fighting. They didn't have those. And you know, the other thing was their sword, the uniquely designed small sword that went both ways. That's what caused the Roman army to win the world, their shoes and the sword. Now, Satan wants me to lose my peace. He wants me to lose my footing. And I believe the one you're going to meet is the roaring lion. And I'd like you to turn to 1 Peter 5:8. Let's look at the principle of the roaring lion. We haven't looked at that aspect of the enemy. 1 Peter 5:8. I always read verse 7 by itself, taught it by. I used to do seminars, you know, on worry and anxiety and how to get rid of anxiety and all that kind of stuff. And I always took verse 7 out of the context. Verse 7 is in a warfare context. You read it at verse 5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves to the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and clothe the humility, for God resisteth the proud and gives grace to the humble. We read that in James 4, so it must be important. God said it twice. You know, if he says it once, it's important. If he says it twice, it's got to be important. You know, I can't miss it. Then he says, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that may exalt you in due time. Verse 7, casting all your care upon him, he careth for you. I looked it up in the Greek finally. I know what it says in the French New Testament. They translate it beautifully, if anybody here knows French. It's a picture. See, we see casting in America, bass casting or whatever, you know, where you go like this and you do this and you cast and you do this. And that's what a lot of Christians do. You know, they cast it on the Lord and they reel it back and they cast it on the Lord. You know, and we get that picture. You know how the French picture it? They picture it a dump truck where the bed comes up and the load slides off. That's the picture here. It's a beautiful picture of letting your load slide on Christ. But this is what it says in the Greek, on the studies I had on my computer. Matter of concern or object of his care. You know, have you ever thought that God didn't care? And he said, what? You're an object of my concern. Isn't that beautiful? He really does care. You know how I know he cares? He said so. He said, you're an object of my care. You're an object of my concern. Yes, sir.
If you want a slightly more literal translation.
Give it.
It says, what concerns you?
Isn't that beautiful? That's beautiful. That is absolutely beautiful. We got to remember that, don't we? Because the enemy attacks us and we think, you know, what difference does it make? And then I'm in trouble. You know, once I buy that lie, I lose my what? I lose my peace. My peace begins to go. I become anxious. You know, if you have a situation in your life that is so big that God can't do anything about it, call me and I'll worry with you. Right? Verse 8. And I can't tell you how many Christians that we see are being attacked by fear. God has not given us the spirit of what? Fear. And this is the attack here to get me fearful. When I have fear, I have no what? Peace. I have no sound mind. I will not make good decisions when I'm afraid. Okay, he says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour, whom resists steadfast in the faith. If we knew the gorillas had planted, let's say you had to walk in this grass out here, and we knew the gorillas here had planted 1,000 mines, anti-personnel mines, like they had in Vietnam, which just blow part of your leg off. And you had to walk 3 miles through this stuff. And we said, well, he said, I don't want to go. He said, well, you got to go. But let me tell you, I'll show you how to detect that mine. How would you walk? Watchfully and carefully. And that's what he's saying here. It's not to be demonically focused, but he said, listen, beloved, you have one who is opposing you who wants to gulp you down quickly. You better walk carefully, alertly, watch, be alert. When he's there, resist him. Recognize when he's there. Let me give you the principle of a roaring lion. Let's say that we're having a meeting here tonight, and it's stormy. And just before we finish, someone knocks on the door and says, you know, there was a carnival. El Carnival was going through the town, and they had a wreck. And a lion got out. But he appeared to be going in another direction, but, you know, they saw we were here, just wanted us to be careful. Now, you each want to have to be the last one here, all right? And so you stay and you want to share something with me, and we share and we talk and all of that, and I'm going to go this way to my apartment. And you had to park out in the street, down the street. And so it's real late, and it's raining, and it's thundering and all. And so we leave, and you're walking down the street, and as you're walking down the street, lightning hits something, and all the lights go out. And it's just really dark out there. And you're walking along, and all of a sudden, you're aware of a patter of feet. And you're going, I can't be. You know, they said it was going that way. You know, and in the midst of all of that, there is a deafening roar right behind you. What would you do? Yeah, jump and run. You know what you did? You made a decision on the base of the lion's roar. And who's running your life? What did he say to do? Stand, resist him, steadfast, don't run. I can't tell you how many Christians are making decisions on the basis of the lion's roar. And they make one here, and they make another one here, and they make another one here. And who's really running their life? The roaring lion. You know that, and I've checked this out when I was in Africa, some of you have heard this story, that when lions don't always hunt in prides, but when they hunt in a pride, the pride will go downhill, downwind, a lion will go upwind and let his scent be smelled. And the zebras or the gazelles, you see in the National Geographic stuff, you can see their skin, you know, creeping. And when the lion roars, which way does the herd run? The other way. And what's waiting for them? The other lions, to prey on the weak, the little ones, and so. They run right into the trap. And so he's saying here, be careful. There's one like a roaring lion. Don't run. Don't let him run your life. Because when you do, you lose your peace. Now, Ephesians 6, I'll tell you how I feel about these. I feel that the first three are positional truth. He says, therefore, having. Verse 16, there's a change. Taking. And if I don't take these up, they don't get up. See, I have the truth. I have righteousness and I have peace. I have those because I'm a believer. But I need to stand in those. But these I have to use. The sword of the Spirit, if I don't use it, guess what? It doesn't get used. If I don't raise up the shield of faith, what's going to happen? My house is going to burn down. You know, I'm the one that has to do it. There's action here. Take up the shield of faith, that you may quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. What is faith? That's really important. What is this thing that quenches the enemy's darts? What he says. Now that's not easy. But I think that's all that God wants me to do. Not what do you call it when you think maybe they want him to do something, but God has not spoken it. Presumption. You know, it can be presumption a lot. I'm not talking about it. I'm talking about just God has said it, and I believe it because God has said it. I want you to turn to Mark 4. I want you to see an illustration here. Verse 35, Mark 4, 35 through 41. And the same day when even was come, he, the Lord Jesus, said unto the disciples, let us go over to the other side. And when they had sent him away the multitude, they took even him that was in the ship, and they also with him with other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on the pillow. And they wake him, and they said unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? It's an interesting thing, isn't it? What'd they say? Don't you care? Yeah, wake up. Don't you care? You ever said that? Yeah. And he arose, and he rebuked. Very interesting, the word he used, rebuke, there. He rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, peace be still. The wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are ye so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Now, unless this didn't happen, let's say it did happen. This was Brad's first trip to the mission field. And Brad is sitting next to me in the airplane, and he wants me to explain all those funny noises, you know, when the wheels go in and it goes clunk, and you think something just fell off the plane, and, you know, and all those stuff. So I'm explaining all this stuff to Brad, and one of the stewardesses walks up the aisle, and she has a funny little knapsack on. She walks to the front of the plane, kicks the door open, and out she goes. And Brad bumps me, and just then, three girls come out of the, you know, the front, fix the food business, and they have little knapsacks on, and out they go. And Brad bumps me again, and the front of the plane, the door opens, and these guys with these hats and blue suits on, they got these knapsacks on, and they go out of the plane. And Brad says, Logan, what's going on? And I said, I perceive we're in trouble. You know, these fellows in the ship, many of them had spent their whole life, and we don't want to underestimate what was going on the Sea of Galilee. I don't know if you've ever gone boating, but there's a family here. We ate dinner with them that sailed down here, and I said, they gave me some real good boating tips. They said, Logan, it's not how much water the boat's in, it's how much water's in the boat. And that was the problem. They said, there's too much water in the boat and we're in trouble. And here the boat is sinking. There's this storm. Jesus rebukes the storm. He turns around and rebukes the disciples. Now, that doesn't seem very kind, does it? And he says, why is it you guys don't have any faith? You know why he said that? Because of verse 35. Now, I have people read this. I won't have you read it because you all have different translations. But I have people read this, and I tell them they read it wrong. The same day when even was come, he said unto them, let us go over to the other side. I said, you read it wrong. And I have them read it three times. They're getting real upset with me because you read it wrong. And I said, what do you mean I read it wrong? It says, let us go out and sink in the middle. See, when Jesus says you're going to the other side, where are you going to end up? Sunk in the middle? You're going to end up on the other side. Now, there may be a storm or two between here and there, but let me tell you, can you believe him? Can you trust him? And he said, you didn't believe me. Now, we're not going to sink in the middle. Christ was even in the boat with them. They could see him. They still thought they were going to sink. We don't see him, so we have a little edge on them sometimes. We don't see when they're going to sink here. We're not going to sink. And we got to believe that. We need the shield of what? Faith. And when the enemy attacks what God has said, what do we need to do? Distinguish that with the truth of God's word. God has said so. Maybe my circumstances are not as nice as I would like them to be at this point in time, but I'm going to stick with him, and I'm going to believe what he said. Okay, let's go to another piece of the armor, because I promised someone I'd end with two stories here that you guys only heard parts of both. Okay. Then he says, take the helmet of salvation. Now remember, the word salvation does not always translate it eternal life. It could be translated deliverance. And you have 1 Thessalonians 5:18, where he refers to the helmet of the hope of salvation. Now does that mean I'm to go around saying, I hope I'm saved, I hope I'm saved? I'm in trouble if I'm in that situation. But I'm to put on as a helmet the hope of what? Deliverance. That's what he's talking about, the hope of deliverance. I am fighting the enemy. What's he trying to tell me? The major attack against my mind is my situation is hopeless. If it's hopeless, leave your people group. If it's hopeless, leave this mission. Right? If God can't do anything, bail out. And the enemy wants me to think that my particular problem or my situation is what? Hopeless. And when I read you the testimony of the fellow that tried to kill himself, just the first page, inject his arm. Then he went to counseling and spent, I think it was $23,000 for 1 month of counseling, and they said he was hopeless. He said the only thing that didn't keep him from killing himself after spending that month with Minerth and Meyer was that if he didn't succeed, they put him back in there. And he couldn't handle another month of that. See, if God can't do anything, it's what? It's hopeless. But we have a God that is what? What does it say in Ephesians? My God is what? Able to do. Well, either that's true or he's not true. God is able to do. And the enemy's going to say, your situation is hopeless. It's not hopeless. And don't buy that lie. And then the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. This is so vital. If you are grieving the Spirit, then you are wielding the sword. And it may not work. Because it's only words. Do you know that every word in my King James Bible is in a dictionary? What makes the difference of the words in the dictionary and the words in this Bible is if the Spirit makes them what? Alive. And I have to be a Spirit-filled Christian. Then that becomes the sword that the Spirit uses. Otherwise, it's just I'm saying verses. Do non-Christians know those verses? Do non-Christians quote verses? Sure they do. They'll quote. My uncle quoted a verse. I didn't even think it was in the Bible because it was dirty. That was long before I was a Christian. He said, I would never be a Christian. This verse is in the Bible, and he quoted this verse to me. And I didn't even find it in Bible school. It wasn't until years later. One time I was reading, and I saw it, and I'm going, my uncle quoted this verse. How in the world did he find this? He was a drunk. You know, and it wasn't any sword of the Spirit when he was quoting it. You know what I'm saying? It was just words. I like what Chuck Swindoll said. And you said he's been down here. Chuck Swindoll said this. The sword of the Spirit is not the Bible.
And he was a long pause, and I think probably a lot of people turned him off on the radio by then, but I knew there was going to be a clincher here. He says, it's not the Bible. It's the memorized Word of God. The Holy Spirit can't bring to your mind scriptures you don't know when you're in battle. And that's why we need to be what? Back into the book. So that when we come under attack, we can come against the attack with what? The truth of God's Word. Because remember, in every attack of the enemy, there is a greater or lesser lie. And if I don't see the lie, what's going to happen to me? I'm going to be defeated because I'm going to receive that lie. And remember, deception is not, we talked to on the first night I spoke, deception is when my mind and my emotions believe a lie. So it's not just an attack of a lie, it can be an attack of feelings. You know, remember we talked about you don't just think you're inferior, you're what? You feel inferior, so I have to be inferior. Because my feelings confirm it. And we come under this terrible attack. Jesus used Ramus, and here it's Rhema, it's not Logos. Jesus used Ramus against the enemy. He quoted the truth of Scripture against the enemy. Now, I want to move down here because there's another aspect. I was going to read you some quotes of neat people, but we don't have time. And that is, the other weapon is prayer. Praying always with all prayer and supplications in the Spirit, watching thereto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. I want to talk to you about, right now, real quickly, prayer targets. Some of you know about prayer targets, some of you have never been exposed to it. A prayer target, I'll explain it and then you can jot it down, it's real simple, is that I assign a prayer target for every area that I come under attack in. Let's say that one of your vulnerable areas is you're a worrier. You know, you're a professional worrier, and you know that the enemy's wiping you out all the time with worry. And so what you do is when you're attacked to worry, and all of a sudden you find yourself being defeated or getting anxious about something. If you're anxious for nothing, you're okay. But if you're anxious for something, then you're going, uh-oh, I'm really concerned about this. I'm uptight and so on. Then after you get the, you know, deal with that, and you just, maybe you use that scripture. Wait, I'm not going to receive this. I'm not going to worry. I assign a prayer target. A prayer target would be one of three people. A lost person, a backslider, or a Christian. Be one of those three targets. So after I'm attacked, I turn around, and this is my springboard, that I'm going to pray for this unsaved person that I know. Every time I'm attacked to worry, I sense I'm being battling in that area, I turn right around and I pray for this unsaved person that God would open his eyes to the truth of the gospel, that the enemy's involvement in his life would be bound, that he would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as personal Savior and do great damage to Satan and his kingdom. Do great damage to Satan and his kingdom. And then let's say that you have a tendency with anger. And on that one, you have a guy that you knew that was a pastor here that was so dynamic, and you know that he's living in sin today. And you say, God, you know where he is. Turn his life around. And every time you have a tendency, you know, you're being battled in the anger area, you turn around and you're spoiling the kingdom, the enemy's kingdom, by praying for this particular person. And you say, what happens if I'm still angry and the guy turns his life around? Well, find another backslider, you know, and pray for him. Or if it's another area of your life, then pray for somebody you know, Billy Graham, that he would preach what? Like Paul said, boldly the word of God and do great damage to Satan and his kingdom. And it's not like we're just always ducking in warfare. See, we're coming against them with the word as Jesus did. We saw that the other night when we talked about pride. And then we see it, we're coming against them in prayer and snatching those out of darkness. Let me give you two instances of prayer. And I think you may have heard maybe one of them, or I know you only heard part of one because the tape stopped that they had. One of our board members is Vice President of Overseas Crusade, Dr. Ed Murphy. And Dr. Ed Murphy 2 years ago was to go, they're doing a neat work in India. And they were to go up to these people group that was way up there, and they were going to have a baptismal service and start a church, officially start a church in this part of India. So they wanted someone for the headquarters to come, like our brother here that's from the headquarters, to come out there as an official person to represent the mission in India. So they were many days traveling in a Jeep, four of them, going up to this villages are huge. I mean, when I say village, don't think of your little villages in India. They're mammoth villages. And they were going up to this mammoth area. And just before, and I think they had been 3 days on the road in this open jeep, the town before the town they were going to, as they were approaching the town, some people come out and said, they're waiting to kill you as you drive through the market. You ever driven through a market on market day? You know, you don't even want to go there on market day, let alone drive through it. And all of a sudden, all of them had fear because this was a militant religious group. And they said, what are we going to do? I mean, you can't get there without going through this with an open jeep on market day. And they were really fearful. And they said, let's just pray God's protection. We can't go back. I mean, they're waiting for us. That would be wrong. So they prayed and they asked God to put a hedge about them and protect them because they were about his business. And they committed that thing to the Lord. They went through the market, went up to this place. Nothing happened. They had a tremendous ministry. I think it was 300 people were baptized. The believers, they had put up a shelter where 1,000 people could sit under it, you know, poles with leaves over it so the sun wouldn't be on them. So they're having this big service, and there are people outside. They weren't sitting on the ground. Then Ed Murphy and a bunch of others preached. And in India, when someone comes to Christ, they come down to the front, and they tell you their testimony, you know, how they came to Christ. It's a long, long, long service, especially if a lot of people get saved. So you want to go home and watch Bonanza, you pray no one gets saved, you know, because you're not going to get home very quick. Well, this fellow comes down, and this is the most amazing thing. This fellow comes down, and he says, you know that I was from this town, and you probably wondered why I'm here. He said, we had got together. There are 25 of us in the back here that came to this meeting from this town. He said, we went to the marketplace when these men came through the market 2 days ago, and we were going to kill them. But as we approached the jeep, we couldn't attack them because of the protectors that they had standing around that jeep that as they went through the town, we couldn't get through them. Now, the guys in the jeep didn't see the angels, but this guy saw the angels. So they said, well, that's fine. We'll get them up there. And so they went to the baptismal service. They saw it. They went to this meeting. What they decided to do, because these poles up, if they could kick these poles down and the roof falls down, that's a good way to end a service, you know, right before any preaching's done. So there was 25 guys in the back. Everybody was standing and sitting and singing, and there was a loud crash of thunder that no one heard but 25 fellows. There was a great earthquake that only 25 fellows felt because just before everybody sat down, God shook the earth under the 25 guys in the back and he sat them first. They all fell down. And they sat there and they said this, there is a greater power here than the power we're serving. And he said, I listened and I become a believer. Now, let me tell you another story. This is really awesome, and this has been documented by the university and by all kinds of people. It's so awesome, it's hard to believe because of God's power. We met you know the little missionary here that puts her hair in a bun in the back? Martha? Is it Martha? Martha King. Okay, it's a Martha King. She looks so much like Martha King, you know? Martha King doesn't look like the kind that would take on the world, you know? This little gal, hair in a bun, gives her testimony, and I had to go to Africa, and it was confirmed by the university, by a Western director of a mission, by a vice president of a bank, and so on. This gal went out to Africa, and her job was to reach Muslims. And after 4 years, she came back very, very discouraged. She reached very few. She went to a seminar, and they talked about principalities and powers and spiritual warfare. And she said, I know that's going to work. So she went back to Africa, and she looked for a prayer target. And she said, why should I pray for a Muslim when I could pray for the head of the mosque? So she picked the head of the mosque. This fellow was not only the head of the mosque, he also was heavily into witchcraft. This fellow in Nigeria was so powerful that they were flying from South Africa to study under him. He wanted to run for the mayor of the town. Three people opposed him. He did his witchcraft, and these people are now walking naked through the town out of their mind. Everybody is scared of the spell. And this little gal began to pray for this man's salvation. Because if you get the mosque leader, guess what you've got? You've got an influential man with all of these people. You ever seen an African? I was there when they were at the mosque in Nigeria. Thousands and thousands of men. They look like rugs out in the parking lot in front of this thing, you know, with their posterior in the air and their head down. Unbelievable. I mean, I just could not believe, where did all these people come from in this mosque after mosque after mosque? So she began to pray for this mosque leader, and something very unusual happened in that part of Nigeria. The roof of the houses began to catch on fire, and they burned from the top down. The whole house wouldn't burn, just the roof. Another house, the roof would burn, top down. A fence would catch on fire, burn from top down. It would skip a house, and then another house. It's not like one day one house, another day another house. And here's this gal praying that God would open his eyes, that he might see this, open this mosque leader's eyes, he might see the power of God. These houses are burning. The houses they skip, guess who lived in them? Believers. The people, their important papers were being burned, so they got very concerned, and they went and bought metal boxes. They put their papers in the box. They dug holes in the red sand, and this is all red sand there. They put the boxes in the sand, covered them over, and when they were covered over, smoke would come up out of the sand. They dig them up, open their chest, and all their papers were burnt. So the people decided to take their important papers out of that town to their relatives in other villages, and every place that they took their thing, roofs would burn, top down and stop. Our fence would burn from the top down. And this is where a friend of mine got involved. He has a PhD, and the Nigerian government said, there is something unusual going on here, and we want the geological survey from the university to go out and do a geological survey in this village. And this believer that I know is from India, over this department, had to send a team out there looking for those gas leaks that were coming obviously from out of the ground. And guess what they found? Nothing. But there's just this lady with a bun praying. They were looking for the source in the wrong place. Finally, this fellow came to her and said, your God has greater power than my God. And she led this boss leader to Christ. He went back in the village and he saw these three people. And he thought, oh no, I put a curse on them. I need to redo the curse. So he went and he got his witchcraft stuff and was going to reverse. He was a juju man, is what they call him there. And he was going to redo the curse. And then he thought, I wonder if Christians redo curses like this. So he went back to her and he asked her and he said, you know, what do I do? Do I redo the curse? I mean, I could take this off of them. And she said, no, you burn your stuff. And when he burned the stuff, these three people came back to their same mind and are dressed today in that village. And we're talking about a huge village. And then she took another mosque leader and made him her prayer target. He became a Christian. She took another mosque leader. This gal is doing one of the most phenomenal works of anybody we know amongst Muslims anywhere in the world, on her knees, praying against principalities and powers, praying that God would open their eyes. And God is doing a marvelous work through this gal's life. And I could go on with stories of people that got into really warfare and really begin to deal with this. And Ed Sabosso gives you a plan for any city to follow using a lot of the principles we talked about and some others. Father, we just thank you for your word. How often we put you in a box. We think, oh, they're Muslims. These are mosque leaders. Impossible. Father, we're thankful that you told us that you could do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think. And Father, that if we pray in harmony with your will, we can get up from our knees knowing we have the answer. So Father, help us to look upon our work and see the working of the enemy, what he's doing and how he's trying to oppose us. And then to stand in truth and stand against him. Lord, and to pray for those key people in our area, that they would be snatched out of the hand of the wicked one and become great tools in the hand of Christ. Father, we're thankful for the things that we've learned from your word, and there's so much we just scratched on. But may we see the Lord Jesus Christ as the victor, the one that's high and lifted up. You told us to keep our eyes upon him, but that we're to glance as we walk through this life, because there's one who is called the Roaring Lion, who is seeking for an opportunity to devour us. Father, may we not focus on the enemy, but may we focus on the victor. And we ask this in his name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.